And we started out against lighting. Parent company is HDL. That's my consulting company. I've been doing that since 1987. And I ran a company called OPAV for a number of years. We're the largest paid wireless internet service provider in the state of Michigan, based out of Chelsea. And we closed that up at the end of 2007 because I saw that that was not going to be a place to make money, and got out of that business before we started losing money. And was working with, had been asked to bid and work on wireless Washtenaw. And this was some dream cooked up by a bunch of administrators and local do-gooders and politicians about having a Wi-Fi network covering the whole county of Washtenaw, much like wireless Oakland and Philadelphia and San Francisco and all those others. And I went and met with them and told them that they were not doing it right and that it was going to fail miserably and that they weren't using the right approach to make this successful. But they didn't want to hear that, and they listened to a bunch of other consultants, and they paid hundreds of thousands of dollars for folks to come and tell them how to put their bid packages together. And so I said, well, have fun. And so then when it came around to round two, they were asking for the folks to bid on this, and I said, no, you're doing it wrong. We're not going to do that. And they got mad at me. But I said, no, you're doing it wrong. So I was frustrated with wireless and the internet service. I had been doing this stuff. Been doing the computer stuff for years and years and years, and the second nationwide hosting company, we launched that in 1993, when nobody was doing hosting back in 1993, still doing hosting services. So it just pissed me off, frankly. So the city council member by the name of Brian Robb, he heard me complaining about this bitterly, and he said, well, if you're so damn smart, Steve, why don't you just go do it? Mm-hmm. It was sort of hard to argue. I mean, it's not that hard. It just the approach that they were doing is wrong. And the approach that they were doing is, I can't remember how many, 120, 180 square miles, you know, the typical size of a county in Michigan. And there's just way too many cows and sheep that don't need Wi-Fi. Hmm. And they wanted to blanket the whole area. And I said, no, put the Wi-Fi where the people are. And I said, no, we need to get this out into these remote areas. These people are complaining about they don't have internet out there in the country. And I said, look, eggs and chickens may be cheaper out in the country, but internet's not. And if you're living out in the country and you're 40 miles away from downtown Ann Arbor, bad news. You don't have a lot of internet options out there. And the reason we got out of the Wi-Fi business and the wireless business in Chelsea is because people didn't want to spend money paying for Wi-Fi and paying for wireless internet. Because they'd say, well, Steve, I can get Wi-Fi for or wireless internet service for $20 in downtown Ann Arbor. Why do I want to pay $100 where you are? I said, well, because it's more expensive to get the wires and the towers and everything else out where you are, and there's only 8 of you. And I've got 800 of us in one block in downtown Ann Arbor. I said, so to get that service out to you, you got to pay. Well, I don't want to pay. So I said, okay, well, we'll do this. So what did we do? Well, we came up, the whole reason that, when Brian came to me and said, well, let's do it in Ypsilanti, I said, I'm tired of this. And so people don't get it, I'm bored, I'm frustrated. And he said, no, let's do this. And there was a restaurant in downtown Ypsilanti that didn't have Wi-Fi, and he didn't have any money to buy an internet connection. It was a great restaurant, but he was struggling. And the guy across the street had Wi-Fi, but it sucked. And so I said, well, you know, I've got these Meraki radios that they sent me about 8 months ago as some beta test when the company was first starting. And they're supposed to be easy to configure. Here, take a couple of these. And I figured I wouldn't see them. And 2 days later, he came back and he says, okay, I got this working. They're all talking to each other. And now what do I do? And I said, ooh, you got this working in 2 days. He says, well, I just plugged it in, went into the dashboard, configured it up, plugged it in the internet connection, and it worked. Oh, cool. So now are you ready to help us? No, I'm not ready to help you. So I said, well, what are we going to do next? I said, go down to the businesses and talk to the businesses and see if they'll let us put one of these radios in their window. Go across the street, the guy that's getting an internet connection, and see if you can plug one into his internet connection, and then plug another one into the window. And then we'll go down the street, a couple of doors down, and across the street, we'll put one in there, and that window will zig back over. So on New Year's Eve, 2007, they're walked up and down one of the streets because all the bars were open and they're talking to the owners. And they call me on New Year's Day and says, okay, we got 8 people that want to do this. And I said, cool, okay, so let's do this. I got 10 radios, 8 people want to do this. So we put some radios up, The other week we had 30 people that had actually used the service. It's like, this is great. And more importantly, the place where we like to go for our brats and ribs now had internet access. So it was really only self-serving that we had this. But by the end of the month, by the end of January, we had like 300 users. 300 different people had used this network. And they started talking about it on Facebook and on the blogs, and what's this wireless IPSI thing? And we said, man, maybe we've got something here. So we got a little bit more serious about it. And we started putting out more radios. And it took off. And wireless IPSI now, well, here's the stats. We just celebrated, we made our official birthday February 1 of 2008. So we just had our fourth year birthday. We've had over 450,000 devices connect to our networks in 4 years. We've moved over 30 terabytes of data. And we're averaging 1,500 to 1,800 users, devices per day. Now, if you show up today and connect up, we're going to count you. You show up tomorrow, we're going to count you again for tomorrow's stats. But as far as total devices, you only count once. So that's 450,000 unique devices that have connected up. We've got nodes in Detroit and in Ferndale, Royal Oak, Ann Arbor, Saline, IPSI Township. We've got stuff out in Albuquerque, Texas, Florida. People just keep adding this into the network and into the community. And so a big portion of my business, HDL, is now going around and telling other communities, hey, you can make Wi-Fi work. You don't have to spend a lot of money to do it. And if you focus on one thing, and that is put it where people are. Well, I gave you a little bit about the history, but who cares? It really just works. You literally just plug the radio into the internet connection, you add it into the dashboard, and you go a couple hundred feet and you put up another radio. If you put some outdoor units out, and you can put all sorts of fancy antennas and directional beams and all this sort of stuff, and you can shoot this stuff a quarter mile, half mile, no problem. Now, when I ask this, 10 reasons why downtown IPSI? What this is economic development. What we're talking about here is, if you ask people, do you want free internet? Well, what's the answer?
Of course,
everybody says they want to have free internet.
What's the catch?
Right, yeah. Right. Well, okay, that's the second one, what's the catch? But if the only question is, do you want free internet? The answer always is yes. And if you ask people, do you want to lower taxes? They'll go, I want lower taxes, that'd be a great idea. So, don't ask if you want free internet. Ask the question, what brought you to Ypsilanti? If you're coming to visit, and you're coming to shop, or you're coming to eat in one of the local restaurants, if you came to look at an apartment, or you're coming to locate your business, or you're expanding your business and you decided to stay in the downtown area, why did you choose downtown Ypsilanti? Now, wireless IPSI doesn't show up number one or number two when we ask that question. It almost always shows up within the first five. And when we first started doing this, we actually, because I pissed off the wireless Washtenaw guys and everyone else because I told them that they were doing it wrong. Then when we were doing this and we wanted to get some help by getting the towers on the fire station and at City Hall and everything, then nobody wanted to talk to us. So we couldn't get on the city poles, nobody wanted to do it. We had to do this guerrilla approach, stick it in the windows and do it that approach. The better way is work with the community and get on streetlight poles. Oh, and by the way, not only are we doing this, people have taken this exact same model. And there's 400 to 500 people in downtown Dearborn every day that use the open Dearborn system, based on the same technology. Lincoln Park is doing the exact same thing. There's one other that's down in that area. E-Course or somebody else that's down in that area is doing that same thing. Yeah.
Three location questions. Chelsea, are they in this?
No.
How about Manchester or Napoleon, south of Chelsea?
No, not that I know of. No. But I'll tell you how to do that. That's coming up. How to do that in those areas? So the Chamber of Commerce and the Economic Development folks were asking these questions, and they kept getting calls at City Hall about how do I find out more about this wireless IPSI? Or when they were doing these surveys for Economic Development, wireless IPSI kept popping up. So they came to us and says, "Okay, Steve, Now we get it. What do we need to do to help? And it's been great. Now we're on City Hall towers, and they've given us access, and we're at the DPW, and they're not providing bandwidth because they don't want to get this whole thing of government paying for internet access. But they're giving us access and not charging us or anything to do that. And we're getting on city poles, and we're in parks, and it's cool. It's working great. We're at the city pool, and we're at the senior center, and we're in the City Hall, and so it's working out great. Because that's what this is all about, is economic development and bringing people to the community and having a brand. You think about it, it's Lanny, you go, oh, it's wireless MC. I go there and I can open up my laptop when I'm at Hobbs or at one of the local bars, and it just works. And it's on. So that's what I mean by reasons for downtown it's Lanny. I believe every public space needs to have free Wi-Fi. So if you live in a community that doesn't have free Wi-Fi, you should be working on this to make this change. So that churches, meeting places, public parks, pools, libraries, anybody else where people are gathering ought to have free Wi-Fi. You are gonna do it. And if it's not you, it's gonna be your neighbor, and it's gonna be some other geek or chiphead, or it's gonna be somebody else in the community that says, hey, I can do this. And we'll help you do this. It doesn't cost a lot of money. What we're talking about, this is an outdoor radio. Now, I talk about Meraki because I like the technology. And there's this whole other group out there that says, no, we need to do this open source. And hey, believe me, I'm all about open source. But I'm also about, it's just got to freaking work. And the problem with the current implementations of Open Mesh and that solution is there's not enough stable hardware that I can run this on, except for one, Ubiquiti. And there are so many variations, it's hard, nobody is actually focused on reliability. They're adding all these features and everything else, but they're not working on the thing about reliability. Meraki really gets the reliability down. I plug it in, it figures out which other radios it can talk to, it adjusts the signal strengths between the different radios, so if one comes up, one goes down, it figures it all out. If you plug this device in to the internet, it's considered a gateway. If it loses its internet connection, it automatically turns into a repeater and starts casting about saying, does anybody else out there know how to connect to the internet? And if it can find some other radio that's in the network, then it will then just route the traffic out there. Now, it's not load balancing, it's not best path and all this sort of stuff. There are some things there that we can help in figuring out how's the best way to do that. You typically don't want to plug in, if one business has only got a 768 DSL connection, and the guy halfway down the street's got a 16 or 22 meg Comcast connection, it's actually better not to plug this one into the 768, because four or five radios are all going to go into the 768. Just make this one a repeater and run them all down to your faster connection. But that's basically it. They're $200. That's all these costs. So if you've got an internet connection in your senior center, or you don't have one, if you can get them to pay the $50-$60 for internet connection, you plug one of these radios in, now the senior center's got access. It has to be affordable. In order to make it work in the community, you've got to have people who are going to continue to work on it. I can come to a community and say, we need to have wireless in downtown Ferndale. Nobody's going to care, because they don't know me, they don't know wireless IPSI, they think I'm just trying to sell a piece of hardware. But if the downtown merchants come along, or one of the business people or young entrepreneurs that are starting in Ferndale comes along and says, how come we don't have free Wi-Fi? Those guys do. Then all of a sudden the Chamber of Commerce says, well, what do we need to do? And it says, well, I need $500. I can buy two radios, and I want you to either pay for an interconnection or let me share that internet connection. And I'll explain about sharing internet connections in a moment. And then we can put up two radios, and then we can go see how many people will connect up to it. And I'll tell you a quick story. I wanted to, we have, in this lane, we have this incredible park system. It was designed by the Olmsteds group out of New Jersey or Connecticut, wherever they're from. Same folks that did Philadelphia and Central Park. And they did the whole park system in Ypsilanti 100 years ago. Yeah, it's right along the river, it's beautiful. And I, when I'm not eating ribs, I like to go to the park. And we don't have Wi-Fi at the park. And we have all these great events. We have the Orphan Car Show, and we have the Heritage Fest. We have all these events. We have 100,000 people come in for some of these shows for a weekend. And the Ellis Festival, of course, is one of the most famous ones that are there. And there's no internet. And yeah, I can get my 4G, 3G, like, you know, whatever, and I can look like a hazard in a lightning storm. And I can do that, but I'd rather just be able to open up my laptop and it works. So we worked really hard with the city to get their permission to plug this in. And how much power does this use? Well, using the most expensive rates for electricity in Detroit, we calculated out that it costs about $3 a year to power one of these radios. It's only about 3 watts. It's nothing. So for $3 of power that we're getting from the city, let us plug it into their little shed there and put a pole up there and we'll attach it on there. And we did. I finally got the permission to do that. I'm climbing off the ladder. As I'm coming down, a guy, a local reporter, comes up. What are you doing, Steve? Oh, install another radio. Takes a picture, writes a story the next day. And I'm loading the stuff into the truck. And I get back over to the laptop, fire it up to make sure the radio's up, and I look at the stats, and there's two people connected. There's only one of me. Where is the other? And then I look around, and almost at the other end of the park, there's a guy sitting there at a bench that wasn't there 20 minutes before, and I see his laptop. He just stopped, turned his laptop on, and says, hey, is there free Wi-Fi? And so before we even got out of the park, somebody was starting to use the system. We see this all the time. You turn this on, and people will sign on and use it. Now, so that's how to make it sustainable, is you've got to have local support. You've got to have an advocate in your community that's going to help push this. But this doesn't take a lot of time. I mean, I don't spend hundreds of hours a day or a week or a year managing this network. I don't even touch this thing for weeks on end. It just goes. It just works. Now, legal. That's a very important point. We're not stealing bandwidth from other people. That's one of the things that the Wireless Washtenaw guys started spreading rumors about what we were doing, is that we were snarfing other people's bandwidth and making it free. And we're not doing that. We're not, you know, we have to have a connection to the internet. So we're not just getting stuff out of the air. But terms of service of a lot of service providers don't allow this Wi-Fi sharing. Comcast changed their agreement for their business class in 2011, beginning of 2011, saying that they no longer allow it. Man, let me tell you, up until January of 2011, we installed a crap load of Comcast internet connections because it's fast, they're easy, I could order it 3 days later, they show up. I can tell you all the statistics that we get because we have like 40 different internet providers that are providing bandwidth into the system. So I can tell in Michigan who's reliable and who's not. And as much as we want to bitch about Comcast, Comcast is stone cold more reliable than any other service provider in Southeast Michigan. Without a question. Blows everyone else away. And the worst is AT&T.
Mm-hmm. Huh. I just have a problem with you.
You know what? And I every time I talk, I always have someone, Comcast, I can't get this thing. I understand. There can be all sorts of things. There can be pedestal problems. There can be point of entry problems. There can be wiring. There can be hornet's nest. I know. There's all sorts of things that can either make it work or not make it work. I'm just telling you on a broad scale where we've got, just in Ypsilanti, we've got over 40, and we've got over 100 different internet connections going. So now we're starting to get some real data.
I can tell
when AT&T goes out, because I've got 16 radios will go offline. AT&T's off, yeah. And we even tag them now. We say which provider it is, so that we don't have to all of a sudden panic. We see 16 gateways all go down. Oh, look, they're all our DSL, AT&T, they're right.
Is there a difference between the DSL and the U-verse?
U-verse is much more reliable.
That's what I have.
Yeah, U-verse is much more reliable, but not very prevalent. Getting there, but not as prevalent. And a lot of times, people buying U-verse think they're getting the fiber U-verse service, but are really getting DSL service. So that's the confusion that some people, because when they do that bundling, they don't really tell you. I'm not picking on AT&T. AT&T has helped us a lot on this project. But they just sometimes it's not so good. Somebody had a hand up.
So costs. What does it cost to buy a line that is shareable?
Anywhere from $20 to $100 a month. Because most of the DSL providers do allow you to share with no limitation.
The Comcast now.
It's slow enough, we're not worried.
What's that?
It's slow enough, we're not worried.
Well, yeah, it's true. It's, you know, it's 3 megs or 2 megs service, but okay, so you buy 6 of them and you spread them out around your downtown area or your neighborhood or around the parks or wherever, and so yeah, that's what you do. The AT&T U-verse just changed their terms of service, and they went the other direction. They removed their clauses that said that you can't share the connection.
Oh, cool.
So as near as we can tell right now, UVerse allows you to share out with no problem. We're pounding the crap out of Comcast right now, and we're working with our congressmen and FCC and other folks to try to say, hey, what Comcast is doing is not fair. Because what they're saying is, if you bring a Comcast connection into your business, into a commercial building, I can light that whole building up with one connection, and I can put connections into everybody's office, and I can have Wi-Fi for the coffee shop, and it's perfectly fine. But if I put that connection into an 8-story apartment building, and I light it up, and everybody that's a tenant in that building wants to access the internet, Comcast says, no, can't do that. And my argument is, now wait a minute. What they say is that, no, you're taking sales away from us, you've got to get the service into every apartment. And my response is, no, wait a minute, you didn't make me buy service for every employee in that 8-story building. But that 8-story apartment, you're saying yes. And I'm perfectly willing to buy the commercial service. I'm not talking about residential service. I'm perfectly willing to buy the commercial service.
Now, what about a business building that, like the town center in Southfield, for instance?
Turns out that if you're a business with Comcast Business and you bought your service after January 2011, if you have an open Wi-Fi network, you're in violation of the terms of service. Okay. And the sales guys don't know that. But they do now, because I've met with their VP out of Southfield and said, you can't be telling this and not doing this. So that's a little different. And Comcast is very good. If you signed your contract before January 2, 2011, you're grandfathered under the old terms of service, and it's allowed under business.
You are still using Comcast.
So we're still using a ton of Comcast. And if we have anybody that threatens to turn it off, we continue to pay for it, so we don't lose that. We don't want to lose that contract.
Right.
Yeah. So we're still doing that. So that's what we talk about in legal. Is you got to check the terms of service.
So do you have a list of providers? I mean, reading those legal agreements.
No, because everybody's community is different. Hmm. While business allows it, while residential does not, though some of the WOW guys are a little unhappy about this and are thinking about rewriting their agreements, but we're using WOW, like down in Lincoln Park, and the City Hall bought a WOW connection, and they put it on their city poles. I've never actually been to Lincoln Park. It's great. They bought 8 or 10 of these radios, bought it directly from Rocky, didn't get it from us or anything like that. And they're DPW guys, the guys that hang the Christmas lights. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that hung the lights out there. They plug them in the plug, put them on there, put straps around there, and put them out. And then they'd call me during the day, said, it doesn't work. And I said, okay, well, when I get back to the office, I'll take a look at it. And I get home at night, and I log in. It works fine. I would come back, tell them the next day, I said, looks great. And then they'd say, doesn't work. And finally, somebody at the DPW said, you know, I think those poles are on timers. Because they were for Christmas lights.
Sure.
Yeah, so I'm looking at night, works great.
Yeah.
They're looking at it during the day when they don't work so good. So the DPW guys, it's going to be a good deal. We'll just switch every pole. And they were able to go back in and rewire the poles and make every fourth one always on it. And the service has been working great for 3+ years. So but there are challenges that you run into. We even have solar.
Wow, that's cool.
This is a solar. Now, unfortunately, Meraki doesn't sell this anymore, but we got a bunch of these, and there's still some out there. And we can actually take any radio and you can power it up. But for a while, Meraki sold this with the charge controller and battery and everything else. And it's tuned for Michigan. But it's a 40-watt panel, so if you got 3 days of no sun, they work great. And and so we have one of these in that same park where I was talking about, where the guy hooked up 2 minutes after I finished plugging it in. This is at the north end of the park. Not this exact radio, but that exact configuration, because we don't have that skylight view in this way. So
yeah.
but not quite that skylight.
No.
We've got a wireless.
So that would make a good repeater, but what about actually plugging that into the internet? You got to run a cable over there.
That one you actually can't plug into the internet. It only is a repeater.
It's only a repeater.
And so what we're doing for this one here, we're bouncing over to the DPW, where we've got a pole up there, and they're giving us power at the DPW, and then that's going over to a bar that's got internet access, and they put a radio up on the outside of the building.
What's the distance that that'll go? Like,
you can usually go 600 to 1,000 feet.
Because it's
600
Wi-Fi.
Feet to
1,000
feet, not 600,000 feet.
No.
So it's 5 to a mile. 6 to a mile.
Yeah, something like that. You can go a little bit further. Sometimes, every once in a while, I'm stunned by how well one of these will work. Because every once in a while I'll see stuff that reach out 3/4 of a mile with a really good DB signal.
Yeah.
But I don't plan for that. If it works, brilliant, but I don't I In a normal city block, two or three per block works beautifully, if you get them on the outside.
Okay, so I tried this, right, and I had trouble with trees, right?
Trees are bad, right?
So what frequency do you use in a heavily foliage area?
Well, this is all 2.4, and the more advanced, there's now a new set of radios from Meraki, but they cost a lot more money. It's their enterprise that does 5.8. But for the cheap stuff, I'm sorry, the low cost, the cheap stuff. Yeah, the economy model. The pro version, that's all 2.4.
Okay.
And so you're right. Trees are terrible. And this is one of the complaints that I had with wireless flush now. Because they came to me and said, we're going to run this big test and we're going to have the... And I says, great, when are you going to do this? And I said, well, November through January. He says, great, who picked that date? He says, well, that's what the consultant said. I said, good plan. Because you got no leaves.
Right. Yeah.
I said their network's going to work beautifully.
until May.
And I said you want to have a test. Put the thing up between May and August. Let me know how this all works out for you. So you're exactly right. So what you got to do is you got to get above the trees, or you got to get below the trees and have a whole bunch of them. But we're talking in an urban area, not trying to cover 600 acres farm, or trying to go on 10-acre or 20-acre lots, house to house to house. You know, we're putting this in an apartment building, and that's three stories. We'll put two or three radios in there, and everybody in the apartment building get access.
Okay, so I was working in a suburban area with the homes and the trees and all that stuff. So you're saying put it above. Have you actually tried that in like a suburban area to put an antenna up above the trees? No. Okay.
Because again, the suburban area is not where people are gathering. You got people that live there, but the suburban people, almost all of them already have their own internet access. They already got it. I mean, if you think in your neighborhood, is there anybody in your neighborhood that doesn't have internet access?
There's a dead spot between Ann Arbor and Plymouth.
Oh, right, but there again, that's outside that urban core. So again, if you want to try to provide the coverage over the area, this is absolutely the wrong, stupid technology. That's got to be WiMAX, it's got to be LTE. That's what it has to be, because then now, we measure Wi-Fi in feet, and WiMAX and LTE measures it in miles. And so if you need to cover feet, this is a great solution. If you got to cover miles, this is not going to work. Now, can you do a neighborhood? Yeah, I did it in my neighborhood. And we, about every two or three houses, we put one on the front of the house or on the back of the house, and we bounce it all around, and we're covering two blocks in each direction around the house. It works fine. You just may need a few more. And then at that point in time, get it underneath the canopy. Sweet spot is around 8 to 12 feet off the ground. It's a good location for these outdoors.
Okay, so I tried WiMAX, and, again, that was the trees and all that stuff. So you mentioned WiMAX. Is that... Yeah, basically for the backbone, or would you actually do WiMAX?
You can do WiMAX at what they call the CPE, or the customer premise equipment, the end piece of the equipment. Remember, your Sprint phone is a WiMAX device.
All right, so I had like a $5,000 base and then a $300, at that time, customer premises. And again, you couldn't cut through the trees. Have you haven't come up with a solution for...
Sure, it's all about bandwidth. Wi-Fi is in an unlicensed 2.4 gigahertz spectrum. That happens to be the exact spectrum of your microwave that you heat up your ramen in. Okay, it's also one of the frequencies, one of three frequencies that's used for cordless phones. So, I always love this. People will call, my Wi-Fi doesn't work anymore. And then it works out just fine. And you finally ask when it happens, and then you finally figure, oh, it's when they make your coffee. Or when the phone rings.
Happens just before dinner.
It's just every time. And then I eat, and then it works great. So to address what you're talking about, when we do WiMAX in for other communities, and we're helping other communities do these large scale community developments, not this what we're talking about, wireless IFC. WiMAX operates in a variety of different frequencies, 2.4, 2.9, 3.4, 5, 5.4, I think there's a 4 somewhere in there too. Most of that is licensed spectrum. Some of it you have to just put in an application, and as long as there's not somebody else in that spectrum, you can use it with a small application fee. Other spectrum is very limited in what's available. You have to pay pretty good sized fees, and you do negotiations. And let me tell you, it's very entertaining to do that sort of stuff around here, because you want to talk about spectrum management, we have this other country nearby, and so, you know, tuning stuff around in the Detroit, Southeast Michigan area is really intriguing and entertaining, because I got to make sure stuff doesn't blow over. And so, but those different frequencies will penetrate through leaves and buildings, no problem. Typically, now I'm not an RF engineer or anything else. I'm just a guy who needed internet at his rib shack. But typically, the lower the frequency, the lower the number, the better penetration you're going to get. So 900 megahertz works very nicely to penetrate through leaves and buildings and garages and all that sort of stuff. Problem is, that lower number has less available bandwidth. I can carry more bandwidth with that higher frequency. At 5.8, that's why your 5.8 carries a lot more than 2.4. So, it's a trade-off.
Is there a trade-off on the distance that it travels to?
Well, yeah, but that's based on the power and what's allowed by the FCC and all that sort of stuff. And also, in the American way of doing everything, more power is better, is actually the wrong thing to do in the Wi-Fi business. Because it's just like turning the volume up to 11. Okay, so great, I can hear some noise a quarter of a mile away on my speakers. I can't hear anything intelligible. Same thing works in the internet. And this is why Wi-Fi was difficult when we were doing this stuff without that. We had to tune all these settings about the dB levels and the power levels and the aiming in the antennas, and was it a vertical orientation or what was the polarization? And that's what's really beautiful about this thing. You don't have to mess with any of that stuff. Plug it in, stick it in, up and it goes. And it figures it all out for yourself. And one of the important things that any sort of network, especially a Wi-Fi mesh network, and remember, this is a true mesh network, because there's two antennas in this device. And so the important thing is the power. And while this radio will go to 200 milliwatts, it typically operates at 25 to 40. But it figures it out on its own. And so if it's bouncing on along at 20 milliwatts and everything's great, and then one falls out, power goes out on that, then this thing says, oh, I lost the connection. What if I turn the power up a little bit? Hey, I can see that guy now. So it'll bring that power up in order to see that next radio. That's why these things work so nicely in a mesh, and you can lose one. You saw that, you pointed that a moment ago, so you got 9 radios down. Oh, okay. Because if one or two goes down, the thing just reconfigures itself and life is good. And then when that radio comes back up, it says, whoa, I'm seeing something way too strong here. I'm seeing 60, 70 dB. Let's back down that power a little bit. And if you reduce the power, you get to move more bandwidth. So what are the threats? Well, net neutrality, yeah, I don't have to describe what net neutrality is to you folks, so I'm glad about that. But the Comcast issue is a big threat. Because the carrier is saying, well, you know, you're taking business away from us. Well, we're not selling the service, for one. And my argument is, if I buy the water from a water company, who the hell cares if I want to give it away to my neighbor? Mm-hmm. And what's happening, what Comcast is saying now, this is why I'm really bothered by what Comcast is doing in 2011, is if I buy that internet connection and I share it with 20 employees in my building, that's perfectly acceptable. But if I want to take that same exact connection for the same exact price, and I want to share it with my 72-year-old neighbor next door who can't afford internet, Comcast says, no, that's not allowed. And it's the use that they're saying is not allowed, not what I'm actually doing with the connection. They're not saying that I can't do Netflix or I can't do YouTube. They're saying, no, because I wanted to give away what I bought to my neighbor and not charge. Now, I fully understand. I'm perfectly with them on that. If I'm reselling it, yeah,
well, yeah.
I'm totally cool with that. But if I paid for that internet connection and I haven't blown past any of their limits or anything else, what does it matter? And I argue, what's the difference with me and my wife sharing it with my neighbor next door? I've got three people, and my neighbor across the street who's got the same Comcast connection, and six kids, two of them are in college. Because from a use standpoint, they're going to use it way more than I am. So this is a little bit of a variation on this whole net neutrality argument, but I contend that it is just as troublesome. that if they start saying no, certain types of people can't use this, can't share, then this puts this whole plan into trouble.
Mean that if I wanted to use this at home, let's say, and so right now I have Ubers, AT&T Ubers, and people come over and we, and I give them the numbers to get in.
Right.
The SID and the numbers to get in. But if instead of that I said, hey, I don't want to be giving that out anymore. I'll just plug in one of these things. And then anybody can connect to it because there's no password on it, I presume. Or is that a configurable?
That's a configuration. We could put a password on it.
You could, but
you don't. Because we want you to be able to use it without having to call somebody.
Would AT&T object to my doing that?
No, AT&T won't because they just changed their contract. And as near as we know, I'm not an attorney. I don't work for AT&T. But in our reading of the AT&T terms of service, it appears to be okay.
So now,
but don't resell it. If you get three of your neighbors all together and you're all going to divvy up the cost of that and everything else, that's a resale agreement. Not going to be allowed. But if you wanted to do that. And in fact, this is what's cool about this technology. That's a smarter thing to do than to hand out your SSID password to whatever your neighbors or friends or whatever else to do. Because one of the things, and this is configurable, and we turn this on. When you connect up to a wireless IFC device, these Meraki devices, we call them wireless IFC devices, but it's a Meraki device. When you connect up to it, I can't see your laptop, you can't see me. Can't bridge, I can't share the printer, can't mount a hard drive, can't do anything. More importantly, when I'm at that coffee shop, I can't see any of the devices on that local network. So I can't see the printer, I can't see the QuickBooks computer, I can't see the credit card processing. All I can see when I connect up to that Meraki device is the internet gateway that takes me out to the outside world.
You can
sniff the wireless devices. You know, you can do snort and all this other stuff to be able, because stuff is just moving out in the air. But when I'm connected to the wireless IFC and I get my IP address, and I've got your IP address, I can't ping you, I can't telnet, I can't do anything to that one. That one would have to VPN out to some other place. This one has to VPN out, and then we can marry out in the world and come back. But just trying to share a printer or mount a hard drive or any of that sort of stuff. So this is actually better for a business to do this than it is just to go buy a $50 router and plug it in, which usually just opens us all up to other things. And so in your case, this is a perfectly reasonable thing to do. And the other thing that we do is we bandwidth throttle. Now again, that's a configurable thing. But we're not trying to provide unlimited bandwidth, and remember, we're getting bandwidth for free from local do-gooders and businesses and homeowners that are willing to share it out. We don't want to tear it up and make them mad. Mm-hmm. So we throttle the bandwidth back. It's about 1 meg down and about 256 up. They basically DSL service. Hey, it's free. Don't like it? Go pay $50 and go get an internet connection. So in your case, if you did this and you shared it out with a couple of your neighbors, it's not likely that even if two of them were pounding on Netflix, that you're even going to notice the difference. And this is not going to go out, four blocks in every direction. It may go one or two houses at the most. So it's a cool idea to just do that. And then I get to say wherever town you live in that you're another node on our network. And it's
And so I had a couple questions. You see me as a node on the network because. I'd be plugged into my own connection there, but you would be able to find me through the...
If you join into the wireless IFC network,
okay,
you can also create your own network. You can buy this Meraki device, create your own network, and you can just be the network of data. And that's yours. Or you can say, here is my MAC address, add it to your network, and then when you plug it in, it'll show up on our network. And then when it's plugged in, when it's part of our managed network, it has all the rules that we apply to all the devices. Mm-hmm. But we can use any backbone. That's what's really cool about this. I'm not backhauling all this traffic to some cluster controller and having to then take all of this terabytes of data and try to pay for bandwidth. We don't care. We'll just go out anybody. And down in Texas, we go off a satellite link. Because they literally are out in the middle of nowhere. But they got a 1 meg down and 284 up satellite link. It works actually pretty good.
What do these devices cost?
$200 for the outdoor. The indoors are $75, but they don't make those anymore. This is the only one in the low cost that they make. But the indoors are 60 milliwatts, and they're $75, and the outdoors are 200 milliwatts. You can use the indoor.
But they don't make the indoor anymore.
The outdoor, is 200 milliwatts. The indoor is 60 milliwatts, but they don't make the indoor anymore. They just sell the outdoors. But we have a bunch of 75s. I had a couple of questions. I want to make sure I get them in order. So yeah, you were next.
The church, how much to rent one of those things for a weekend? How much to rent one for a weekend?
I've never asked anybody to rent one. I've had people borrow them. What are you thinking?
No, this says occasionally the church has functions.
Oh, well, they should just get one and then have it plugged in all the time. They don't want to rent one. I mean, it's only $200.
Well, for that church, that's a bet.
Yeah. So everybody put $20 in and you got 10 people and you got it. Yeah, right. And then the only thing you have to then pay for is the internet connection. And we have a bunch of churches that hook up into the network and then do this. And what's really cool is they're providing bandwidth, but they say, hey, we don't want to have access to porn and hate speech and that sort of stuff. And is there a way to block that? I said, yeah, actually we can. We have to do a couple little tricks on their routers, but we can set it up so that their network that they're providing the bandwidth is filtered in a way that is acceptable to their church, but I don't have to filter the whole network. It's only that point where it's going through the network. And so if you're next to the church and you don't agree with it, well then go get your own connection and we'll get you a radio and we'll get you hooked up. So in the case of a church, $200 plus whatever it's costing for an internet connection, they probably already have an internet connection even if it's just temporary, or even,
The part that interested me was, okay, directories has the internet connection. They play with the bookwork and all of that stuff there. Says, okay, we're having 150 people live for this function. It'd be nice to have it this weekend.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, one time I'll loan you a couple of radios and you can get this to work, but the better deal would be to buy a couple of radios, and then it's always there. And then we solve the problem. Remember what I said. I believe that every place where people gather, even if they only gather there a couple of times a week or once a month, ought to have free Wi-Fi. And if you've already got an internet connection in there, two of these outdoor radios will cover almost every church that I've seen in Southeast Michigan.
But my thinking is everybody's saying, what do we need it for? But like you said, with the park, once they see it, then they expect it, then they're willing to pay for it.
Right, absolutely. And more importantly, I mean, they don't talk about, sometimes you do this in a church, but the whole reason of building a building rather than just putting up a tent every Sunday was so you didn't have to put the tent up every Sunday, and it's permanent, but it's not necessarily occupied. But if you had internet, then you can start teaching classes, and you can start having people come in and do things in the community, and it can be a public meeting space, and all of a sudden now the church is being used for something more than just on a Thursday. Yeah, I have a couple more questions. I want to make sure I get to them.
If you had, say, a note at Dave's house, could he say, I do want a password on it, but still want it on your network?
No.
Okay. So when it's on your network, it doesn't have passwords.
Right. No. It, to be part of wireless IMC, we don't have passwords. But he could just buy this radio. We'll show you how to connect it up. So like wireless Ferndale's rolling their own wireless Ferndale. And so if they, for some reason, wanted to have... Oh, and you'd have multiple SSIDs on these, too. You'd have two SSIDs. So on the Pro version, and then if you take the same radio, put on Enterprise, you get four SSIDs, and then the higher radios, the more expensive ones, $800 for those more expensive radios, they can go to 16 SSIDs. So you can do VLANs and all that stuff for the enterprise stuff. But on the low end, you can have two SSIDs. So I can have the open one and throttle that down to 1 meg, and then I can put a password on the second one and not have that throttle. Guess what we do? Our network. We got it, so people ask, what's the password? We don't have the password. We just use that network management. Truth of the matter is, no, it's not filtered, and we've got the password. So you can do that in your own network, and we'll help you do that.
So you're connecting to the same radio, different SSIDs,
yep,
with different rules to those.
Correct.
So you don't throttle in and
And also, I put a WPA encryption on that. So I connect onto that second SSID, and I'm encrypting my traffic between here and the radio, and I've got a password to get connected up. So it's sweet for me, because I actually hate leaving Ypsilanti. Because I'm just used to going around anywhere in Ypsilanti, and I got internet access. It's great. All right.
Okay, so even the residential areas in Ypsilanti?
We do. We cover a big part of the residential areas. There's one side, east side, that's probably 3 or 4 blocks and maybe 100-125 homes. And it pretty much covers that whole area. Because there was I call them internet evangelists. And there's a couple of guys over there. One of them is Dave Strensky with Solar Ipsy. And he says, this is great for our community. We need to have solar. We need to have internet. And so he's been encouraging all his neighbors to put up radios. And what we do in Ypsilanti is, and we just do this in Ypsilanti because it's too hard to start to travel. But if you want one of these radios, we'll come over and install it for free. Dave and I will just come over whenever we can on a weekend or evening or whatever else. And we'll put one of these radios up. You'll pay for the radio. We'll put a radio up for you. And so that's, again, back into that community. I'll help you if you want to do this in your community. I'll help you figure out how to do that. We'll go through the first couple. Once you learn how to do one or two, boy, they go up fast. All right, we got to move on because we got a lot of stuff. We're now at year four. And one of the things that we're running into is some people are not making sure that radio stays on. Or do I need to be paying for an internet connection? Or does it really matter if I unplug my internet connection from there? And so they've just sort of expected. And so we're now going through this. We're always still learning about this process. But now what we're doing is we realize we need to go back to the people that helped us out to get this started and remind them and thank them that we still need you to do this, and this is important to keep this going. Because if they don't pay that bill or they don't keep that electricity on or it falls off the window and they don't bother sticking it up, it starts to hurt the network. The other thing that we've run into, we've had to block people from being stupid. Mm-hmm. We have a splash screen that says, don't do BitTorrent, don't download movies, and don't sit there and stream Netflix all day long. And invariably, somebody will do something stupid like that. And so we block people. And we've had to deal with people, you wouldn't believe this, we've actually had death threats over free Wi-Fi because we turned them off. It's like, holy cats. So it really is sort of amazing. But we've created this whole support structure, and now we can take phone calls and we can do internet support and all this other stuff. But we've had to do this to respond to folks. And again, we do this for no charge. So if you wanted to roll wireless in your community, then they'll just call us for tech support and we'll handle it. We have a phone number. If they call at night, we don't answer. works great. And so we'll call you whenever we get around to it. If you send an email, we'll respond a lot faster. But when I talk about indifference, what I also is people just sort of expect it. And so when a business leaves, it created a hole in one of our networks. And in fact, the RIP place, it went out of business. And so so fortunately, we got a new RIP place that's opened up in a couple of weeks. But the old one, they went out of business. And it created a hole in our network. Because no electricity, no internet, and then people, well, it doesn't work, and it's crap. And then they post up on Facebook about how wireless sucks, and you know, and they just go on and on and on. They go, well, slow down for a moment here. A, it's free, and B, it's depending upon somebody else in your building to share it out. You've been getting it for 4 years for free. How about you turn it around, and you pay for the connection for a little bit? Or we'll take Yahoo, the PayPal donations, throw $25 into the pot so we can go buy some more radios. And so, but that's part of this thing that we're learning after 3 or 4 years. That's back to being sustainable and learning that. Now, the other threat is BitTorrent. Man, this is awful. Because what happens is, okay, you're sharing your connection out. Somebody downloads a BitTorrent movie from the neighbor next door, and they're downloading the movies. You'll get a letter about 3 weeks from now saying, you downloaded something illegal. And then they call us. I don't want to lose my, you know, whatever. And they want to turn off the internet connection. So as much as we try, we can't tell down to the port level and the packet level and any of that sort of stuff. We can look at broad scope. And you know, you see a couple of gigabytes in a day. It's not email. So I already talked about a little of this. Evangelize Wi-Fi. Why it's important to have it in public spaces, wherever you're going, whether it's a coffee shop, the senior center, the church, wherever else, say, why don't we have this here? And if they want to do it, come see me, I'll help you do it. Set up a node at your home or at your work. Where we did the presentation at...
They went to that.
They did that. Right. This is what was the name of that company?
SRT Solutions.
SRT Solutions, right. Thank you. They have you know, Linux dev days and all this sort of stuff in there, and they just go nuts for 30, 40 hours. And they were always having to hand out the password. And then someone said, you know what, that guy's right down the street at YPSI. How come we don't talk to him? So we come talk to him and says, this is what we need to do because we've got a bunch of public people coming here and they're killing our bandwidth when they do. Oh, well, sweet. Let's put one of these YPSI radios in. So they just took one of these, stuck it in the closet, plugged it in, and then anybody on there only gets 1 meg connection. They got a big freaking pipe, so they can have 20, 30, 40 people pounding on the network all at 1 meg chunks, and they're still not going to suffer. But it's way better than what it was before, because one guy could basically bring the thing to the knees if he was trying to download, or, I love this, because we also help, like Michigan Theater came to us a year or two ago, they were doing a TEDx event. 10 days before. You know, I don't think our Wi-Fi is going to make it. Yeah, I bet not. Because I knew what they had. They had Linksys routers and all this other stuff. So we came in, brought in the high-end stuff, loaned them, like what we were talking about there. And then their internet connection sucks. So we begged from one of the local internet providers, 123.net. It's a great guys. They brought in a WiMAX signal for us. We were able to float in a 10-meg connection wirelessly into their building. And within an afternoon, we got the whole thing set up. We had over 100 people simultaneously accessing it. And even though TEDx is broadcasting this thing and streaming on the internet, there's always some fool with an iPhone streaming from the audience, you know. And they're flinging out the Wi-Fi. And there's always more than one of those guys. So, you know, we can tamp that down. And so I always tell folks, if you have an event and your Wi-Fi doesn't work, that's stupid. Because there's no reason not to have Wi-Fi at a big event. And there's a famous video of dearly beloved Steve Jobs, who, for the introduction of the iPhone 4, go look this up on YouTube, it's a great video, where he has to beg the audience to shut down all their Wi-Fi devices so his demo will work. That should never happen.
No.
But the BitTorrent is a problem, especially in college areas and in residential areas. It's not a problem in the park, it's not a problem in the church, but where we have residential stuff, it is a problem. Now, when I gave this presentation before, we were really under the gun to try to solve this BitTorrent. We've got a solution to the BitTorrent problem right now, but I want a better one. And so this is why whenever I come to these groups, and I got a bunch of chip heads and techies here, then I'll say, okay, here's what I'm thinking, and if you want to help, this is what we need. What we need is a device to sit between the router, that Comcast connection, and our device, which is just Ethernet, that costs less than $50. I can manage it remotely. I've got that twice, so we only have 5 minutes on our list there. I need to be able to use OpenDNS, because I can do filtering with OpenDNS, but I need to also be able to prevent people from bypassing OpenDNS, and so what I need to do is block port 53, so that DNS requests only go to OpenDNS, and they don't go to Google DNS to get by that stuff. And it would be cool if we do layer 7 filtering, because then I could really throttle down Netflix and YouTube, but give huge bandwidth to email and web stuff. Turns out we have solved this problem for the most part, but it's a one vendor solution. Netgear has a capability that does all this except layer 7 filtering. And used and in bulk price, they're $50. So they get close to it. Then retail is about $110 for their solution. But it would be very helpful if we could have one of these little small. This is a device that initially Tornado, I think, is what it's called. They were going to come out with their little wall plug Linux box, and they were talking about $50. I think right now they're in the $100 to $110 retail.
Raspberry Pi is talking about $35.
Yeah, there's a couple of folks that are still
That's still going to be.
Soon, but that's more geared towards like video, isn't it? Maybe.
Yes, and streaming.
Yeah.
Yep, that's exactly right. So those are the challenges that we face in doing this. We talked about the legal challenges. We've talked about some of the technical challenges. We've been pretty much able to get over most of the technical ones. The biggest thing is just getting people to say, hey, I can help. I want to do something, what can I do to help? And so that's part of what we do. And when let me tell you how I make money and how I do this. When the city of Ferndale comes along, or we're doing downtown Windsor now, they pay us to do this. Your church comes along and wants to do that, we do it for free. We'll help you whatever we've got to do, because we're so passionate about getting this out into community centers and places where it's going to do this, that we will do that for free. But if you're gonna try to do your downtown and the Chamber of Commerce and all those other folks, then you know we want to be paid for our time.
Just build up on the hour, do you have a fixed price?
Yeah, we build on that. Yeah. And And like in the case of Windsor, they fortunately had bought these radios but didn't know how to run them. They turned out they had a Meraki network. And they called us about a year and a half ago. This is a great story. Last story, and I'll answer any questions you got. And they called us and they said, we got this Meraki network, but it just doesn't work. I said, you have a Meraki network and it's 40 minutes away from me? I didn't know about it. And I said, yeah. Why'd you pick Meraki? This is great. He says, well, we heard about wireless IPSI, so we sent a guy over into town, and he walked around downtown Ypsilanti, and he saw one of the radios, and he saw that it said Meraki, so we called them, and we ordered some radios in.
So, how do you spell Meraki, and where's the website? How do we, you know?
The company is called Meraki, M-E-R-A-K-I, and it's Meraki.com. And you can buy the pro radios from them. You can also buy them online. PC Connection, Buy.com, some of those other folks sell them as well. If you are hooked up into distribution with Ingram Micro, you can buy it directly from Ingram Micro and get a little bit of a discount. I think they're like 20% or 25% is Ingram's price. And so that's the company, and that's what they do. My company is HDL, been around for a while, so it's HDL.com. And Wireless IPSI, nobody grabbed that name, so it's not too surprisingly called WirelessIPSI.com. So that's a little bit about the websites and what we are. So now, I've answered some questions, but
how many other towns in the area here are doing this?
We'll probably
is Northville, is Plymouth, is Canton, is...
The answer to all of those is no. But I think we're probably in 20 communities just in Michigan alone.
Okay, so I could ask questions all night. So let me know when you get tired of hearing from me. So I tried this, and I tried this, and you know, had a community. I was in with the civic association. I was golden with that. I had like almost 10 people signed up in my local, neighborhood, right? We were figuring out the costs and things like that, and that time was like $300 for the individual homeowner to, and it was a Wi-Fi or WiMAX device, and we had trouble where we couldn't cut through the trees and all that. Is this so you're really not suggesting that we do this in a suburban area? It's really more of an urban type. But
you can, because we did it.
Okay.
I mean, we're doing that. As I just said, the east side of Ypsilanti, we're covering 4 or 5 square block area with 100 plus homes. And it's, and I'll show you on the map where it is. This is.
So nobody here has Comcast?
No, some of them are grandfathered in.
Okay.
And then there's a number of DSL connections. One of the big Comcast connections that's feeding that network is one of the nonprofits that's over there has had a connection for 18 years. And they're providing a big chunk of bandwidth into this network. Now this is slow, not because of the cloud, but because we only have a 200K internet connection here.
I think they throttled you.
They must. it's severely hammered.
It's not as bad as Madison Heights Library though.
Anyway, so to get up here to the map here. So if you've ever been to Ypsilanti, this is the train tracks that run through. This is Depot Town. This is the business area in Depot Town. So this is this neighborhood that I'm talking about. That from here to here is this is a long block. This typically would be 4 blocks in sort of a normal urban community. When I talk about a normal urban community, I'm talking about something that was built in the last 60 to 100 years. Newer ones where you got all these cul-de-sacs and everything else, that there's a different density.
Is it 4 blocks to the mile? 4 blocks to the mile?
Approximately.
And 8 blocks the other way.
Yeah, approximately. This is not, Ypsilanti is only 4.5 square miles. So this right here is probably a half to 3/4 of a mile, this distance here. And you can be anywhere in this area, and in most houses, you'll get internet access. And this is live. So this is telling me how many people connected to this node in the last 24 hours.
Hmm.
Nobody connected to that node. But this node is actually a critical repeater node because it's bouncing traffic around a bunch of them because this one's sort of sitting high on the hill. That's our co-founder, Brian Robb. He's got a very high connection and he's got an internet connection. His grandfathered in, 33. This is an important gateway. Gateways look like a home plate. So that's an important internet connection. So. That's the Corner Brewery. They have their own internet connection. 26 people at the Corner Brewery connected up the last 24 hours. Sidetrack, another big bar, restaurant there, 30 people there. co-op, great coffee shop, ooh, the best bread around. So that's, you can do that. You can do that in your neighborhood if you want to. And what I would suggest is just get a couple of these radios and go try it out. We do what Brian did. He got two or three of them. And the thing is he had to figure this out on his own. We'll help you.
Okay, so
and it's not hard.
All right, so
we'll buy a couple of radios and we'll get you going.
Okay, so radio to internet connection ratio. I don't know how many. I mean, so you're saying like there's 33 on this big one here.
Yeah, don't get so involved in that. I'm sorry to be dismissive of that. Just put them up. Seriously, if you start worrying about my density level and am I going to get 6 to 4 to 12? Am I doing 2x2 radios and 3x3s? And am I tuning the antenna to be at 6?
Okay, no. My concern is more. Will my mom get it, you know, 3 blocks away from someone who has it, or is this going to be like so sparsely, you know, populated that we're not going to, you know, be really getting anybody and that type of thing? So
the best way to find out is to actually just put them up.
Yeah.
And to try it, because they don't cost very much to do, and you can spend an afternoon putting up 2 or 3 of them, and you can just make them temporary if you want to. You know, get a 10-foot pole from Radio Shack, stick it to the side of the house, run a couple of tie wraps around a pole, and run some indoor cable, or an Ethernet cable,
yep,
down into there, and then go walk back. How far does this go? And the thing is it's got pretty good technology in the radio. You connect up to the radio, you can see what the connection is from radio to radio to radio.
Mm-hmm.
And you can also see the connection from your device, your laptop or your desktop or your tablet, to the radio, the access point that you're connecting to. And so how do we figure this out? Because everything is different. You can try to, I see the heat maps and the consultants come in. We did a school. The consultants were in the school for 2.5 days doing heat maps. We came in a half a day and just wired the whole damn thing. Because we just put them in. And seriously, we plug it in, we go down about 3 classrooms, and we look at our little laptop, and we're saying, hey, I got 38 dB. That's way more than I need. Let's go to the next classroom. 22 dB. That's still going to work. Go to the next classroom. 16 dB. Yeah, not so good. Come back over to the 22 one, put a repeater there. So that's going to get the connection just fine from that 3 or 4 down there. And now I've got another repeater in there. Wait about 5 minutes for the thing to come up. Start broadcasting around. Start stepping down the classrooms again. Get down around to 16 to 20 dB. Time to put another repeater. Now, how many repeaters should you do before you do another gateway? That's a great question. Should be about 5.
So you can go literally 5 repeaters out?
5 hops.
Roughly?
Because we're only delivering 1 meg to the client. And you figure this is a 54 meg connection, theoretically. We make the math easy, 50 megs. Remember, we're only probably going to have a 3, 6, or 10 meg connection out there. But, so, the first radio is 50 megs, the next hop is about 25 megs, the next hop is 12.5 megs, the next hop is 6.75.
Is
that at 4 hops, I'm still at 3 to 4 megs, no problem. And so, and what am I restricting that guy to? 1.
Is that configurable to? Is that 1 meg, is that configurable?
Yes, you can have it unlimited, you can make
it
768.
I wouldn't have to leave that on there.
If you weren't part of the wireless IPSI network and you had your own Dave's wireless network, you can make it anything you want.
If I make it part of wireless IPSI, though, it isn't 1 meg.
It is not, it is only configurable for the entire network. Okay.
All
right. Yep.
Couple questions.
Yeah,
Are they POE?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, well,
that's good.
That's a great question. Thanks for bringing that up. The question was, are they POE, or power over Ethernet? You bet. That's what makes these things fun.
That's right.
Because now I don't have to do an electrician.
Right.
And because it's low voltage, I run my Cat 5 up, outdoor Cat 5 cable, $75, 500-foot spool at Home Depot, cheapest place in town to get it for the outdoor radio cable. So we buy a lot of cable from Home Depot. And so you put it up on the pole. One of the ways that we like to mount these things, we actually spin this thing around this way. We use hose clamps. Hose clamps are a beautiful thing, or tie wraps.
And on a pole.
And what we'll do is we'll take a piece of conduit, stick it up 6-8 feet above the roof line, put a couple screws down below it, take 10-foot chunk of conduit and have it about 6 feet up, put it up there, run the cable down. It's got a seal area. These things are really waterproof. Now, I mean, you can swim with them. But they're fine in Michigan winters. We've not had a single water failure on any of these ever. And
freezing ice and stuff out of them.
Don't hurt them. Don't paint them. We've had several people says, you know, I've got my $6,000. Can you believe they pay $6,000 for these designer light poles in these downtown districts? But that's what they cost. They're blue and black and green and everything else. Then you stick one of these things on, oh, it's a white. No, don't paint it because they'll heat up. If they're not, that's why there's color so that because they do generate heat and they'll overheat if they can't shed heat. That's why ice doesn't collect on them because they do get warm.
Okay.
So you stick that up there, run it down, do a little drip loop on your pole, about not that much down, about 3 or 4 inches, zip tie that whole thing down, go into there, comes with a little plug-in PoE adapter, and you plug that into the wall, and then if it's only a repeater, then you're just sending the power up the wire. And then on the other side of the adapter, if you're going to make it a gateway, just plug that into the internet. It senses that, hey, I got an internet connection, configures itself as a gateway, becomes a home plate, and it's done. And it works great. And the indoor support PoE, too. That was one of the problems with some of the early open mesh radios, is they didn't have, you had to do this goofy PoE thing. And then this is a little bit of a non-standard PoE. So your normal 48-volt Cisco, PoE, you know, devices that you've got in racks and what won't work with these radios, that's what the enterprise class is. And we do this for schools. Like we're doing Warren Peterson, a church school, K-8, I think it is. It's K-12. And they're down outside of Romulus. And we were talking about WIFI, but they needed to do a whole bunch of other stuff, and they wanted to do bandwidth filtering, and they needed to have accountability, and they wanted radio service support and all this other stuff. And I said, go with the enterprise solution; it'd be a lot better. And they've got roof mounts, and they can just attach it. Meraki's really got it. And people keep talking about the company. It started out as Google funded, and there's a bunch of other folks that have put money into the company. Their focus now is not on this stuff. They're more focused on the enterprise. They're competing with Aruba and Cisco and everything else. And when you compare price, it's like half. It's amazing. So we sell a lot of these because people see this. And like we have a big medical research firm out of Ann Arbor doing some really cool cancer research stuff, major bandwidth. They're always moving stuff, lots of files, so big stuff. And they said, well, geez, you did this thing for TEDx. You know, Wi-Fi in my office sucks. What can you do? Let's put up four of these radios. And again, you can try to do the heat maps and everything else. I just brought in five radios. We put four of them around, and I just laid them on top of the shelves. And I said, well, it works. Now, and it says, we don't need the fifth one. And then when you're ready to go, get your guy to run a wire up there, and they have these little clamps that'll just go right onto the drop ceilings, or bolt it to the side of the wall, and you're done. And so a couple weeks later, he finally got them off tops of the desks, and works great. It just works. So, and like the Celine Schools, we did the administrative building at Celine Schools, and again, we just walked around and started putting radios up. You said you have a couple questions. Anybody else have any questions?
So, these all have the same SSID. So you roam from you're walking down the street and you got wireless. And it's just seamless.
It is sort of seamless. However, the Wi-Fi spec does not support mobile Wi-Fi. And when we talk about mobile Wi-Fi, when your cell phone is working and you're scooting down the freeway, there's a handoff that's transparent from one tower to the next. But Wi-Fi doesn't work that way. And more importantly, there's some intelligence on your handset, on your phone, as well as the tower, to sort of tell where everything is. And while there's plenty of horsepower here, the Wi-Fi spec doesn't have that intelligence. And so when your Wi-Fi device connects up to the radio and it's over there, and it gets over to here in this classroom, and I put a repeater here, what happens is it's going to hang on to dear life to that connection there because that's where it started. And so you're actually probably going to get past this repeater. You're finally going to lose that connection, and then your device will go, well, man, I lost my internet connection. There's one right there. And it'll join right back on. And because it's the same SSID, there's no other handshaking it's going to do, it's almost seamless, except when you're streaming video.
or you
got a voice phone. But that's a Wi-Fi limitation.
If these were two different gateways, though, would you possibly end up with an IP address when you do this?
Yes, because when your device reassociates with the next access point, it picks up a new IP address.
So there's a little DHCP server in each of these devices.
Yeah, it's actually not. It's not really in the device. It's part of the cloud controller.
Okay.
This is a cloud-controlled system,
All the radios are managed via the website. That's what this website is.
So these all phone home to a Meraki website someplace?
Yep.
That's where it's
that's how they check in.
So when you go to the management utility, you're going to the Meraki website.
That's correct. I'm going to dashboard.meraki.com. And if I want to click on this particular radio here, I can click on HiScope.
Okay, so you just lost me there. I mean, so I understand.
That's right.
Yeah, each individual, you know, person plugging their thing in, and okay, it's a free thing, everything's cool. Now all of a sudden you're talking about managed centrally. You're talking about just the way you decided to set up your free IPSI thing was you had all the different connections that you manage, right? So someone walks in and puts another one of these devices in. That device, what, is it managed by you, even though they're going through their connection?
It is if they tell us about the device and we register the device in our cloud network.
Okay.
But you can set up your own cloud.
All right.
You don't have to use the wireless IPSI cloud.
Okay, so I'm just...
So you can have your own cloud.
Okay, so it's a privacy, security thing, right? So okay.
You can do that with one device that has the intelligence center. You don't need another...
That's correct. Yeah, so the question is... Is there some other device? Aruba and a couple of other folks, Cisco is one of them, when they talk about these mesh networks, you need a wireless controller. It's another device that sits on your network that manages all the other devices. This is entirely cloud computing, and there's no other device that has to be on your local network or some other device that has to be on our network to manage these things. When you plug a radio in, it connects to the internet, if it's a gateway. It connects to the internet, and the first thing it does is it connects in and it says, which network do I belong to? Because a radio can only belong to one network. So it connects up to Meraki and it says, hey, I belong to Wireless IPSI. And then it says, what's the configuration for Wireless IPSI? Oh, well, this SSID, this is the bandwidth, whatever all those restrictions, and then that radio says, okay, I know what I need to do, next, and then it waits for a customer to come along and connect up to it. So if I want to move it to another network, it's really sweet. All I got to do is take that network, take your, if your radio was on wireless IPSI, you say, I want to do some stuff on my own. You create a new cloud on the dashboard, and you can make as many as you want. We've got 10 or 15 of them that we do for different computers. So you just make a new cloud, and you delete the radio from one, and you add it to the other. And you actually can move it, so you don't even have to delete.
So where is that cloud?
They've got
taking place. Is that on their site?
Yeah, they've got three data centers. They've got one here, one in Europe. They got two in the United States and one in Europe right now.
Okay.
And I think they've got an Asian one coming up. So they fail over as well. So if one is down,
they're supplying a live portion of this, component of this.
Yes, the management side. Now, however, if their cloud is down for the cloud controller, the network still does what it does on its own.
Okay.
It just, if a radio goes offline and comes back in, it won't check in until
okay, so this is administrative back. Function for you to be able to monitor and things like that.
That's correct.
And that's a free service they're providing?
On the pro radios, yes.
Okay, I don't know, is that a pro radio?
That's a pro.
The $200 is a pro?
Yeah.
Okay.
On the pro, there's no charge for the cloud. On the enterprise, it's $150 per device per year.
Okay, so I could start my own network up basically for $200, and if I can convince any other neighbors to buy into this, they spend $200 each, and we just build that out from there.
Yeah.
Okay.
And two guys wanting ribs built this into 500 nodes and.
We had a need.
Yeah. So yes, you can do this.
Okay.
And if it doesn't work, I'll buy the radios back. I'm really that confident. Seriously, it'll work. It's just great.
Right.
I can use them. Yeah. We keep ordering them by the box load.
Can you VPN into them? Like if you have your own network, can you VPN and
sure. Act as your you can. The question was, can you use VPN? So yes, if you're connecting up, if you can do a VPN through Starbucks or any sort of Wi-Fi device, that'll work because we're not filtering ports or anything there. But there are some VPNs that do, that want to come back for part of their authentication. And this is, to get the 10 address, there's three different routers that could be involved in there. It may not come back, but most VPNs today work just fine.
Does it also have a VPN component though? Like,
no.
So if you're outside and you're, and this is like my own private network using this device?
Not in the pro network, in the
enterprise.
Yes. And it's really sweet what they do on the enterprise side. It really is. But on the pro side, they don't do that.
So does each radio have its own web interface, or do you use this and this accesses the radio? So
it does. That's a great question. I'm glad you asked that.
What was the question again?
The question is does each radio have its own web interface? And it does. You can go to my.meraki.com when you're connected to one of these radios, and you'll actually connect to whatever access point you are physically, but actually connected to. You're going to get a status window, status page, via HTTP, that's going to tell you a little bit of information about that radio. And it's going to tell you some really important things. It's going to tell you what it's called, so its name, because this is really funny, or at least it is for me. Every once in a while, I'll be out and around and about, and I'm connecting to a radio, and I go, where is it? Because there's so many of them, and we've been doing this for so long, I can't remember where they are. But it works, because I can see it here. So what is it? Go to my Meraki. Oh, it's on that guy's apartment. Yeah, okay, so now, and then the really beautiful thing is when you look at that, it can tell me some bandwidth, what sort of performance I'm getting from my wireless device to the radio. I've got a bandwidth meter that can tell. And it also tells me the signal strength. And so I can see, you can look right there, and you can say, oh, I'm getting 12 dB. You call it wireless IFC sucks. Yeah, you're right, 12 dB is not going to work. Move your radio closer or get a repeater. So we can tell that very easily on the tech support. I just heavy type my.meraki, and if for some reason that doesn't work, 10.128.128.128, and that connects up to that radio, and I can look at that. And more importantly, one of the other pages on there is a page that allows me to see what that radio sees.
Oh, what it sees on the outside.
Yeah. Yeah. So wow. when I'm connected up to the net to that radio, I can see what other radios around that I can see, and so I'll connect up to the radio and I'll see, oh, I got 22 there, I got 28 dB there, I got 35, and I got 6. Well, that means that 6 is not going to work, and I got 3 other connections all above 20 dB. I'm a happy guy. I'm done. Installation's great. Get into the truck. Go do the next one. That's what we try to target is above 20 dB.
That's just other Meraki.
It's not trying to look at other access points. However, it does, every once in a while, it will stumble across somebody else that set up another Meraki network. We will see the other Meraki nodes, and it will tell us what that network is called. So if someone has called their network Fred's network, we'll see that device, and we'll see that it's called Fred's network. We don't know where Fred is, but we know that there's somebody else around that's got that.
Figure it out based on all of your other connections, be able to see it.
Yeah, and you know, one of the problems you can get into this mesh, and now we're starting to get into some of the geek stuff, but with this mesh, you do have to pick a channel, and in Wi-Fi there's only 3 channels, 1, 6, and 11. And what we have found is 6 seems to work pretty good, but you can be in a really noisy environment. I've got an RV park out in Albuquerque. They've got power lines running all over the place. And if you've ever been to Albuquerque, it's 5,000 feet, big mountains that go another 5,000 feet up on one side, and a pretty good rise on the other side. They go up about 800 to 1,200 feet on the other side, and then it goes off, and you head west out to Gallup. And then you got 700,000 people sitting there in a little bit of a bowl. There's a lot of RF crap all flowing around, and it's all flowing up that hill. And so at the top is this RV park. And the density level, you know, he was asking about the density level. The rules should have said that I only needed 4 radios to cover that part. We got 12.
Wow.
I had to put that many radios in to get punched through the noise, and I had to keep messing around with the channels. So I separated them from wireless IFC. It's still the SSID is called wireless IFC, but this one is called the RV park as my management network. And then I start playing around with the channels, and I'll just go in and say, okay, let's try channel 3. Click, change it to channel 3, and then wait for a little bit. The radios will all communicate with each other. It might take an hour for them to all settle out, and then I can start looking at what dBs are seeing and how much bandwidth is moving between those nodes, and then, okay, let's change the channel to 9, and then wait about an hour, and then it'll all settle out, and we look at it. And we found it, I think we finally settled on 11. 11 seemed to work pretty good in that environment. So there is some capability that we can do.
Are you using the name YPSI all around the country then?
Yeah, we are. In running downtown Ann Arbor, and I love it.
You trademarked it and registered it.
We haven't registered trademarked it yet, but we are.
Well, I imagine how you do.
Yeah, we are working on that.
Name, so it's tough to do.
Well, but wireless IFC you can do.
Yeah,
and because it's a great thing because you know, I mean, there's this whole thing between Ypsilanti and Ann Arbor, and it's just that thing, but.
But outside of Southeast Michigan, nobody knows what an IPSI or an Ypsilanti is. So it's actually a great introduction for us. Because they say, what the heck's an IPSI? and so then we get to tell a couple of minutes about what a cool town that we live in and a Greek general that never lived in the United States and all that fun stuff. And then it says, oh, and by the way, we make networks work. And what can we do for you? So yeah, but in some networks, you know, like downtown Windsor, they want it called free DWBIA wireless. Wireless IPSI would be cooler, but that's what they want. We're doing a network down in Detroit. They call it Detroit Enabled. Dearborn calls their Open Dearborn. Ferndale's doing theirs. Gee, here's a surprise. It's called Wireless Ferndale. We have one in Royal Oak, Wireless IPSI. And what we were doing for a while, we don't do this anymore. If you called it Wireless IPSI, we'd provide free tech support for businesses. But after we got to 500 nodes, we said we don't need more nodes, so we don't need that anymore. So
if I'm in Royal Oak and I associate with something, well, I know it's Wireless. Well, the SSID would be Wireless.
Yeah,
just going to say Wireless IPSI. Yeah. So I would know.
So one of the things that you kind of talked about early on is promoting community and promoting business. Do you have any stats on, like, in downtown IPSI before and after Wireless IPSI to know that they really feel that because of Wireless IPSI that their business is picked up, blah, blah, blah?
No, we don't have any way to correlate to say that,
okay,
that here. And so what we have is some anecdotal data. And that is, there's a restaurant there called the Bomber Restaurant. And not too surprisingly, it's been around since World War II. And because it was open 24 hours a day for the workers at the factory at Earl Run. And they're run by two dear friends who don't have internet access. And I kept hammering on it. I said, look, you gotta get wireless internet here. I don't want to have wireless internet in here. They're just gonna sit down here all day long and they're just gonna occupy all my tables.
Drink a cup of coffee
and not even do that. They're gonna just leech off my free Wi-Fi and I'm not gonna be able to turn over tables. And if you've ever tried to get into the Bomber on a Saturday or Sunday, it's pretty hard. It's pretty busy. And I kept working on her. Finally we got her to turn around. And I said, look, if it's a real problem, just reach over and unplug the radio. Or tell them, it says, I need the table. And it says, you know, you would do that even if they didn't have a computer. If they're just sitting there, you tell them, hey, got to get up. So whether they're in front of the computer or sleeping, you tell them to move. But here's what we heard from her a year later. She said, Steve, I'm seeing people in my restaurant I've never seen before. And they're younger. They're in their 20s and 30s and teens. And they aren't coming in with the computers, but they're sitting there and they talk the whole time. They're not doing this. Some of them are doing this, but mostly they're people that it's all what we know. We're all doing the Facebook and the Twitter and then they get together and they have a Bomber breakfast and they have a great time and then they go off. And she says those people were not coming into my place before. Didn't even know about it. And so one of the things that we're working on now, we can control the landing page. So when you join on to Wireless IPSI, we come up with a little splash screen that says, it's a free network, be nice, don't BitTorrent.
Provided
I think we have the line. What's that?
Provided by these people?
No, we don't. We used to do that, but then the list got too long. And I think one of the things is, remember, keep your tweets below 140. and then click here to continue. And what we did is, if you typed in Google, then you'd see the splash screen, and then Google would come up. Now we're changing this around. And now, because it's a splash screen for the whole network, so if we start subdividing the network and do this. And we don't have location base. I can't tell that you're at the Bomber and come up with a Bomber splash screen. That'd be cool to do that. I can't do that. But what we are is coming up with events. Hey, on Friday is the Corvette Club is meeting. Come to Thursday night Depot Town Cruise. Or
Texas.
And the funny thing is you know, we're going to have to start segmenting part of these networks so that messaging makes sense.
Yeah, I was going to say, so there's more local
yeah, apps, yeah, 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 right. But the thing that we did, and of course you remember the blackout and Wikipedia and everything else. We set our rules for the splash page. Initially, we only did it every 24 hours, which was really generous. I was down in Disneyland, Disney World here, a while back. They do it every 4 hours. That's a problem. Disney World can do it for every 4 hours. We'll start popping up that for the splash screen every 4 hours. And what we did is on that day when Wikipedia blacked out and everything else, we came up every 30 minutes, the splash screen came up and it went and pointed to the Wikipedia page. And we got complaints. It was great. People were complaining that it says, and the best, I saved this email because it was just absolutely classic. She says,
She says, I understand why you're doing this, but it's really annoying.
That's the point.
And at that point in time, I realized, oh, that's the power of that splash page. So we're going to start doing things where we'll do friends with wireless IPSI, and we're going to, you know, do things where we'll hey, post up on Facebook where you are right now, and for everyone that checks in, you know, at the end of the month, we'll give away an iPad or something like that. So we're going to start doing some of that stuff with that splash page that we hadn't really thought about before. We didn't think that there was any really opportunity. But after that, the Wikipedia and the blackout day, we realized, no, there's some real power here.
Or selling advertising on that.
No, I don't think we're going to do that, because again, it's back to it's building community. We've already been approached that way. Because now, if I start selling advertising, the guy that's providing the free Wi-Fi, the free internet, is going, well, I want a piece of that.
That's true too.
And I don't want to get into that.
Sure.
So
my competitor.
Yeah. And then you know.
You're showing ads for.
Yeah. Event. Yeah. Exactly. So you know, I'm sort of wondering about that. But the other thing that we did this a couple weeks ago, is one of the local coffee shops got nominated. What was the best coffee shop for Wi-Fi? And this was AnnArbor.com. We don't have a newspaper in Ann Arbor anymore. But so AnnArbor.com ran this online poll. I got 1,000 people a day check in the wire city. I can make this vote happen. So what we did is they only nominated one coffee shop in Ypsilanti and about 12 in Ann Arbor. So at that point in time, you can get everybody all sort of riled up in Ypsilanti. It says, hey, look, they're picking on us again. And so we pumped up to a landing page, and it said, vote for the best coffee shop and free Wi-Fi in Ypsilanti. And we won. Kick your butt.
Were any of the ones in Ann Arbor using?
No. I checked. But the question was: Was anybody in Ann Arbor using that? And they're not. Though we do have a number of coffee shops and a couple of breweries and stuff like that. All have wireless IPSI there. But they weren't. I wouldn't have done that. All right. Any other questions? Yeah.
You mentioned how you can find out which node you're using. But how do you find the one that the dog chewed the cable that connected it to the tower?
Oh, well, that's the benefit of that cloud controller, because when that radio goes offline, I see a mark up there that tells me that one of those radios is dark. It'll see a red mark or a gray mark. Reds have gone offline in the last couple of days. Gray means I haven't seen it in a while. And our network operations center gets an email saying that radio goes offline. So then we go look at it. And if we get 12 of them, remember what I said, if we get 12 of them all in one time, go, AT&T's down. And there can be a variety of reasons why they can, there's a red one right there. And let's see what the status is on that one. Why is that one not working? Bob, wait for that. A question back there.
I was wondering how many things you
I don't, but I let me ask you, see if you know the one question. How many spaces have they got?
I don't know, a couple hundred, probably a mile square though.
Okay, so you would probably need 10 to 20 radios to do 300 to 400 spaces.
How many?
Because
10 to 20.
The
main thing is can they get some internet connection in there, and more importantly, can we get an internet connection that we can share? But if they can get an internet connection into there, then this is a beautiful technology. And we're starting to work, you know, one of the things that the Indian casinos are doing out west, this is why, is they're doing almost no-cost RV parking. They just want you to come to the casino. And these are nice facilities. And they're offering free Wi-Fi. And they got plenty of bandwidth coming into those facilities already. And so, yeah, we're seeing that as a real opportunity as they're building these RV parks to be able to do that. But, you know, the problem is you get up in the remote areas up north, they don't have any internet connection right there. And so now you're stuck to satellite, and satellite usually limits you to 5 gigs. And so, you know, Johnny in an Airstream is going to kill that in one night on Netflix. So that can be a real problem. Yeah, anybody? Oh, so this says that it's been down for 5 minutes. So I'm not real panicked about this. And it's telling me it's LDMI, which is them telling me that it's a DSL connection.
Oh, of course, that fine company, LDMI.
Which is a provider of major DSL service around this part.
Because they're called
They've been bought out. You know, it was capped out.
Well,
it was
bad service. They changed their name.
It was Paytech for about 3 weeks, and then they just named themselves something new. After Paytech.
It's not Cogent, but Cogent.
But I think they got bought out by somebody else. But anyway, yeah.
Okay.
But, you know, if you've been doing this for a while, you'd be, there's a bunch of them out there. And, you know, when one company buys the other one, they usually don't rename their devices.
Sure.
So it looks like you like to go around and talk about this. And so if we have other groups, you know, that we might want to pull you into, you might be willing to.
You've got a videotape. So I'd rather you show the videotape than me come. Because when I got invited to go down and speak at this large event, they meet every 2 years, they call this Downriver event. And they bring together about 40 different communities. And they said, oh, they got this wireless IPSI. Why don't you come down and come talk about wireless IPSI? And I said, I don't want to do that. And I said, because nobody ever installed a wireless network in a meeting. But I'll come down one time, and I'll do what we just did here tonight, and I'll talk about this. But if you want me to come back, now this is not a suggestion here, but this is what I did with this Downriver group. If you want me to come back, you have to have committed $1,000 to buy 5 radios, and you have to have secured an internet connection. And you don't have to have it installed, but you have to have it ordered or already have it. You go to the Chamber of Congress, you go to City Hall, get one in or whatever else. And I'll come back the next meeting and I'll help you install the radios. And then what we'll do is when we have this big conference of 40 communities and hundreds of people and the congressman shows up and everything else, we're not going to talk about how cool wireless IPSI is. We're going to talk about what you did in your community. Three communities, 4 committed to do this, 3 actually did it for the show. Lincoln Park, one other, this is almost 4 years ago, and Dearborn. And at least 2 of those are still going today. So I would rather come help a community go do this. It would be more fun for me.
Okay, all right.
And it'd be more productive for you to instead of coming to meet with the church elders and or the downtown, you go meet with them. I've explained everything here. And our website doesn't have a lot of details, but if you go there, there's the best thing on HDL is the blog posting. There's a 3 blog posting about why you need to do Wi-Fi in your community. Read that, it'll tell you everything we need to do. And then if you want me to come meet with your community or come do an install, let's go hook up a couple radios and let's get internet going. I'd love to do your church, it'd be great.
Okay, so I'll have this on YouTube in a few days or whatever.
Cool.
Maybe we can send a link. So how about like a large hotel? So we had the geeks in the room know about this thing called PenguinCon.
Mm-hmm.
It's an annual thing. It's like 1,000 people all showing up. They're going to have this at the Hyatt sometime this spring. Yeah, and they always try to wire up and they usually just get the lobby area. I don't know what they're trying to do this year. But so like a big hotel, would that be something you just put a couple radios on different floors?
No, because if you're talking hundreds or thousands of users simultaneously, you need some really serious bandwidth. We're talking 50-100 meg bandwidth to come in to be able to service that hotel. And we're going to be talking about those enterprise radios because now we're talking BGN.
Oh, okay, so let me restate the question. So it's not the people in the hotel getting out, it's the people in the hotel working within the network there. So you just want to set up some radios and then have like a central.
The problem that I've seen in every hotel that I go to is they are usually not prepared for 500 geeks to show up with laptops.
Sure.
No, so that's the point. I mean, is this
And putting up 2 or 3 radios is not going to solve the problem. The problem is it's an infrastructure problem in a poorly designed network with not enough bandwidth. And this is not the solution for that. You need to go with the enterprise solution. We need to go 3x3 radios with 1 gigabit ports, the bandwidth to be able to do that. And when we talk about 3x3, these are MIMO radios. These do AVGN. Now we're moving some real serious bandwidth. Now we're able to do 300 megs on a wireless connection. And we're going to backhaul that all back to a router, and we're going to feed that out in a 50 or 100 meg connection at, you know, whoever's the big dog in that area to be able to do that, to handle that sort of convention traffic. That's what's necessary to make it work. But if you can get bandwidth to the floor,
or to the entry room.
Okay, so again, you're on the, let's connect everybody to the internet.
Let me finish up, and then if I didn't answer that. If you can get bandwidth to there, we can bring in 3, 4, 5, 10 radios, and using this wireless mesh network, pretty much make it work, just like what we did in Michigan Theater, no problem. The critical thing is you cannot use the hotel's own internet connection unless they really know what the heck they're doing. They never have enough bandwidth for your event. So if you can get the bandwidth for your event, that's always the trouble, because usually the bandwidth guy wants to install it for a year, not for a day. And they almost never want to bring in 100 megs for a weekend, unless, you know, this sort of money. But if you can get a sufficient bandwidth in for the 200, 300, 500, however many people you're expecting, yeah, we can do temporary radios. We've got pedestals and tripods and everything else, and we can do an event network up there, and we excel at that. We're awesome at that sort of stuff, and we can do that. But the trick is to get the bandwidth. If you don't have the bandwidth, it doesn't matter that you've got 300 meg connections if everybody is slogging along at 56K. Answer your question?
Nope.
Please ask your question.
Okay, the question is, not connecting to the outside network, just connecting within the hotel, is this a solution that will work?
No, because the cloud is required. The radios have to check in. You're talking about a local network not
yes.
connected into anything else.
Well, not necessarily not connected, but just the checking. I mean, if that could be over a low bandwidth, I mean, so it's not so we have the connectivity between the internal network and the internet for everyone to look at videos on YouTube, it's just to do that checking.
Yes, you can do that. The answer to your question is yes,
okay.
You can do that. But if you want me to do it, I'm going to charge you for it. Because that's now you're talking about business and commercial and that sort of stuff. This is not trying to get his church hooked up.
No. Okay.
Or just trying to get, you know, a comic book convention going for the weekend or something.
No, so that's what I am talking about. The Penguin Con for the weekend.
Yeah, I mean, you can do that. Yes, you can.
Okay.
But if you want me to do it, I'm not going to do it for free. Sorry. Because it's not going to help the community in the long run. The only reason I want to do this for free to help is because we're trying to build community Wi-Fi. That's what we want to do. One question over here, and then I'll... Do you have any questions? Oh, okay.
The impression I had is that you got 500 people trying to watch that screen to get on this local router and watch it on your own laptop type of deal, or talk to your buddy and comment, tweet back and forth your comments.
You can't tweet
without an internet. Never leave the hotel room.
You can't tweet without an internet connection. You can't Facebook without an internet connection. You can have some sort of database to do your check-in and all that sort of stuff, but at that point in time, you're talking such low bandwidth, get 2 Belkin routers and just go. But this will work.
Yeah. The other question.
But if it's not going to have public access, any wireless device will solve what you're trying to describe, and they have WDS and all that sort of stuff, and it'll work.
My other question related is if you have a say 500 people that says to there, you've got 2.4 gigahertz. You said. Channel
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No, when we're talking these large scale networks, now we're moving into the 5 gigahertz frequency, and now we're talking about 60 and 70 different channels that are available.
Yeah, but we're talking his laptop only does.
Correct, but I bet at least half of these devices here are N radios right now. And N radio is 5 gigahertz. And so a high number of devices that we're seeing on the network, especially in these large scale events, are N radios capable of doing 100 megs in there. And the thing is, what you do is if this device is an N radio and a 2.4 gigahertz, a BG radio. BG is 2.4, N is 5 gigahertz.
N is 2.4 and 5.
You can do both. That's absolutely true. That's correct. But if this device is dual band capable, every operating system I've seen, Linux, Mac, and PC, will bias to the faster bandwidth if it's available.
Yeah. But my question is, every one of your machine, Meraki, can only handle certain channel at a time, correct?
The pro networks are only BG networks. They're only 2.4 BG channels 1 through 11. the pros.
No.
The enterprise is ABGN. And now we're talking upwards of 300 megs connections in a whole variety of spectrum, as you've said, between 2.4 and 5.8 gigahertz.
So how many devices can be associated with that access point?
Okay. Those higher-end access points, a single access point, that cost $1,400 a piece, can handle upwards of 100 to 400 simultaneous connections.
Yeah, or a company with cheap.
Yeah. And what we would do in this environment here, we could have about 60 or 70 potential just in this meeting room area. One to two radios would do this one, just no problem.
Please be advised that the internet will shut down 10 minutes before closing. Thank you.
Dinner tonight. Are we in the weekend?